Well, students, in the previous section, we did talk about non-core data. And now, in this session, we'll be talking about the core data and hemi-core data. And as I mentioned, that hemi-core data is a small group of animals, as compared to the core data, which in itself is a big group of animals. And being big, it has further been subdivided into classes, and there are five of these classes that we call as Pisces, Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves, and Mammalia. When we say Pisces, we are talking about fishes. When we take Aves, we are talking of birds. That's the common name for the bird Aves, and for fishes, the scientific name is Pisces. Now, if we look at the Pisces, Pisces are further being classified into two categories, chondrocytes and osteocytes. And so also the birds, if we see, they have also been classified as flying birds and non-flying birds. All birds don't fly. There are few birds only, although their number is less, is comparatively countable on the fingers, that can't fly because of one reason or other. That we'll study accordingly as we proceed with the classification system with respect to questions. The question comes, which of the following is not a true fish? Hammerfish. Hammerfish means fish whose head is like this, like a hammer. Suckerfish, a fish that follows the shark and sticks to the undersurface like this. That as the big fish, shark, eats the other animals, a part of the body of the food happens to spill out. And these fishes, they feed on this part. Like you must have seen the jackals or wolves, they follow tigers. Because once the tiger has hunted an animal, the tiger can't eat each and every part of that. Hence, some of the flesh is left. And then these wolves and jackals, they feed on that leftover of the animal that a tiger or leopard has hunted on or the lion has hunted on. Sawfish. Sawfish is like a saw. Its teeth are like a saw. Like this. And hence, we are left with the correct option to the silverfish, which is an arthropoda. It belongs to the phylum Arthropoda, that is the insect class Insecta. Why is it called silverfish? It's just because when we look at it, it looks silvery in appearance, and hence this word is given silverfish to it. Next. Liver fluke belongs to the phylum. Liver fluke means a worm that infects the liver of an animal. If we look at these liver flukes, they are like this. That's all. And these are also different from the other worms, being trematodes. Trematode means they complete their lifespan in three animals: humans, snails, or a goat or a sheep. And these, if we look at, they are leaf-like, something roughly leaf-like in structure and flat like this. And anything that is any worm or anything that is flat like this, in the category of animals, it belongs to platyhelminths. Platy means flat, plate-like, dorsoventrally flat. We call the word, use the word dorsoventrally flat, like you can say a leaf or a ribbon that the ladies' parts use to tie their hair, etc. So the correct answer comes out of the platyhelminths, because when it comes to ascalemins, it comes to roundworms. All the worms that are round in colors are ascalemins. Annelids, annelida are like earthworms. Now, they are called worms because they look like worms, but they are different, because if I look at an earthworm, a roundworm is like this. This is a roundworm. But if we see the division, the body being divided into small, small segments, then it is no more left as a roundworm. It becomes an annelida. So, a stretched cylindrical body with the tapering ends. Unsegmented is ascalemins. If it is segmented, then it is annelida. Next. Two alternation of generation, such as observed in biophytes of plant kingdom, is found in. Alternation of generation, that means there are two phases of life. One is gametocyte, and the other is called sporophyte. Now, gametocyte phase is the sexual phase, whereas sporophytic is the vegetative phase. This is in case of plants. When we look at animal, gametophytic remains sexual. But sporophytic becomes somatic. That is general growth. Animal is not involved in any sexual activity. Whereas in gametophytic, it is involved in the formation of the sex cells, it is involved in the process of fertilization, etc. Now, this sort of the lifespan in which an organism completes its life in two phases. One, somatic phase, followed by the gametophytic phase. And then, gametophytic phase would follow the sporophytic phase again. Is observed in case of cnidaria, because cnidarias if we look at live life in form of polyp and medusa. Polyp is the somatic phase. Medusa is the reproductive phase. That is, if a cnidaria is vegetatively growing, we call it is the polyp phase. If it, the moment it starts developing or get involved in the development of the sex cells, etc., it changes. It brings some visible changes in its structure also. Then we say it has entered into the medusa phase, that is into the reproductive phase. So, it is the cnidarians which show an alternation of generation, or which show polymorphic stage or dimorphic stage. Dimorphic means two living in two different forms. Polyp and medusa, that is somatic and reproductive. Next. Which one of the following is a warm-blooded animal? Warm-blooded animal I did describe in the first session, that animals have been classified into two categories. The one is open and the other is closed or warm-blooded. Now, closed circulatory system. When it comes to cool-blooded and warm-blooded, animals are cold and warm. Now, what are cold and warm-blooded animals? If you visit a doctor, you would find the doctor will use the thermometer to find your temperature. And he will say that it's 37 degrees Celsius. Whether it's summer or winter, is raining outside, whatever may happen, your body temperature remains same. That means if your body temperature, if the body temperature of an animal remains constant, irrespective of the temperature of the environment or of the surroundings, the animal is considered as warm-blooded. And if it is otherwise, that is, the temperature may go slightly go up or may go down, then we call it the animal to be cold-blooded. That means cold-blooded, also called as poikilotherms. That's another term used for them. Poikilotherms and homotherms. Homo means same. Poikilo means changing. So if the body temperature of an organism remains same, the organism is, the animal is warm-blooded. If it can change with respect to the change temperature outside, that if it is less outside, the body temperature will reduce. If it is more, that body temperature would rise. Then they come in the category of the cold-blooded. And among warm-blooded, we have only two. They are aves and mammals. That is, birds and mammals are the only two classes of animals which are warm-blooded. They have their own fixed body temperature. While all other animals, they are cold-blooded. And if you look at the choices, whale shark, Elias, Draco. Draco is a lizard. Flying, that's another name for the flying lizard. Alite is an amphibian, a poisonous toad. Whale shark is a fish, while whale is a mammal. And as I mentioned, that apes and mammals are the one which are warm-blooded, which have got the fixed body temperature. So A comes out of the correct option. Next, which of the following do bats or dolphins use to find prey or avoid predator? Bats or dolphins? Both bats and dolphins are mammals. First thing. Bats are aerial, whereas dolphins are aquatic. And bats are nocturnal. They fly at night. Dolphins are found in freshwater, even the Ganges. They are Gangetic dolphins. Though they are endangered now. But they are there. Now these, they continue to fly or to swim in the water. And how do they swim? Now, in the sound, in physics, you must have heard of the word sound. And in sound, you must have heard the word fathometer. An instrument, a device that the shape or the submarines use to find the depth of the ocean. Or any obstacle going out, go in the forward direction. What they do is that if the ship is sailing in the water like this, they send the waves forward and they send the wave down. Now these sound waves, in the down, when they strike the bottom, they reflect back and come back. The scientists use this time the waves take to go and return in order to find the depth of the ocean so that the bottom of the ship should not collide or rub with the surface of the ocean. In the forward, if the waves come backward, then they realize that there is some obstacle in the front, and hence they change the direction in order to avoid any collision. And whenever a sound wave goes back and return, we call it echo. We call it echo, reflection of sound. And this reflection of the sound at the same point helps the shapes, the bats or dolphins, etc., to find any obstacle or to find any prey, etc., predator, etc., on their way in the forward direction or in the downward direction. So we call it as echolocation. A technique, echolocation comes out to be a technique or a mechanism that these animals use to find or to protect themselves and find their direction of motion, propagation. Next. Which of the following is a cold-blooded animal? Animal that can, that have got a fixed body temperature, the warm-blooded, and the one that do not have is cold-blooded. And we did learn early in that the animals belonging to the birds, the class of aves and mammals are the warm-blooded animals. Whereas the lower animals, whether they are reptila, amphibia or pisces, they are all cold-blooded. And among the options, if we look at pigeon is a bird, tortoise is a reptile. Now, fox and goats both are again mammals. Hence, the tortoise being a lizard comes out of being a reptile, animal belonging to the phylum, belonging to the class Reptilia, become the cold-blooded animal as to be the correct option. Next, which of the following is a fish? Sea anemone, sea cucumber, seahorse, starfish. Starfish is an echinodermata. Sea cucumber is again an echino. Sea anemone is a cnidaria. It is seahorse, which is a real fish because it's like this. It's like this that the seahorse is. It swims in water like this, with the with the name, scientific name called hippocampus. Right. So the seahorse is the name for one of the fish, which is a bony fish. We also consider it as bony fish. You will learn later, a bit later. Now, this question, the animals belonging to the phylum chordate are characterized by, now this is a very important question. Because as we see that we classified the kingdom Animalia into chordata, non-chordata and hemichordata. Now, for this category of the chordata, what are the four characteristics an animal must have to be placed into this list? Into this group. Is it presence of notochord? Chord to chordata, yes. Presence of dorsal hollow nerve cord, that is the backbone, yes, again. Presence of pharyngeal gill slits, yes. Because gills In the Pisces, then in the amphibians, gills developed or modified or evolved into lungs. And from there onwards, animals have lungs. And then post-anal tail, that means tail at the end. It is only humans and gorillas who do not have the tail, while the rest of all animals have the tail. Although humans and gorillas also have the tail. When they are developing in the embryonic stage of the development, they did have tail. But later, as the tail degenerates as they grow and take birth. So, looking at the option AB, ABCD, ABC, and ABCD, if we look at it, then all the four options are correct. For an animal to be considered as chordata, animal should possess notochord, hollow nerve cord, pharyngeal gill slit that should open into the pharynx, and the tail, the post-anal tail, because this is the mouth, the other end of the alimentary canal is called anus, and the tail grows behind the anus. Therefore, we call it as post-anal tail. Next, the class of vertebrates or chordata, in which the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood get mixed is fishes, amphibians, birds, and mammals. Now, oxygenated means blood rich in oxygen, deoxygenated blood rich in carbon dioxide. If we look at fish, in a fish, the heart is like this. These are the walls. The blood comes in and goes out. And we call it venous. In amphibians, we see the heart like this. Blood comes in before it goes out to the body, and from body it comes in. So at this place, what happens? The intermixing of the blood take place because the heart is three chambered. In case of birds and mammals which are warm-blooded, in both these cases, what happens? The heart is like this. One, two, three, four. All the four chambers of the heart are completely separate. The blood comes in from here. It goes to the lungs, get oxygenated. Oxygen adds in, carbon dioxide goes out. And then this blood with the oxygen comes in here. From here to number four, and from number four back to body. Such that there is no intermixing of oxygen, oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Therefore, the option B, the amphibians, comes out to be the correct option. The ones in which the blood get mixed, oxygenated and deoxygenated. Even in the class Reptilia, we realize that the reptiles like lizards, snakes, etc., they also have the heart like frog, like amphibians. So in them also, the blood get mixed, for the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood get mixed up. Next, the chordate is characterized by double circular respiration or double intake of air are called or belongs to Pisces, amphibians, birds, mammals. Now, double respiration is the characteristic of the birds. Because if you look at the bird, fishes have got what we call a swim bladder. But all fishes do not have the swim bladder. There are some fishes, there's a class called cartilage fish and bony fish. Bony fish have the same bladder, cartilage fish do not have the same bladder. But all birds have got air bladder. Now, one is that the air that they breathe in, either it goes into the lungs, or it goes into air bladder. Now, in physics, you must have understood about the buoyancy, floating. That means when the bird fills in the air bladder with air, birds get lighter and it rises up. When the bird expels the air out, it becomes heavier and it comes down. So a bird respires twice. One to fill the air bladder or to vacate them and tie them. And the other is for the lungs, for the process of respiration. And hence it is the birds who are known to be characterized by the property or by the characteristic of double respiration, one for air bladder and the other for the process of respiration. In fishes, there are gills. Same bladders are there, but only in the, what do you call as bony fishes. And hence, we cannot put a tick on fish because there are other fishes also which lack them. Next. The largest and tallest of all birds is, this is a very important question I should say, or a question which has been repeated many times in last few years of exams so far, in one way or other. Either it may say a bird, which of the following is the largest bird, which of the following is the tallest bird, which of the following is the heaviest bird, or which of the following is the bird that lays the largest egg. Now, if we look at this, the correct option for this is ostrich. Because all these three, these are non-flying. Peacock is also almost, though we can't say it is non-flying, it does fly, but not fly long distances. But it can still fly. But the other three, iria, emu, and ostrich, they are large birds. But among the largest is the ostrich. It goes up to even a height of 1.5 meter or above and weighs more than 150 kgs or so. And back in Africa, where it is found, it is reared like hens or chickens are reared in the poultry farm. There are farms in Africa which rear these ostrich because of the flesh, just like a chicken flesh, eggs, which are the largest shell, and for the feathers, because the feathers, feathers collected from them are being used for different of the cultural processes or rituals, etc., that the them. Believe they're in Africa. So the tallest, largest, biggest egg with the biggest egg, the answer rests onto one, and that is the ostrich. The smallest of all the known birds that can fly both forwardly and backwardly. Smallest bird, largest bird is the ostrich. The smallest bird that can fly forward and backward. Although we see the birds flying forward in one direction, the straight, we don't see the bird going up and down, forward and backward. We don't see that. But there is one that can do that. Which is that? Woodpecker, hummingbird, peahen, or house sparrow. If we look at these four choices, the smallest of all the known birds is the hummingbird. And because of its voice that it produced, because it's a very small bird, bird, like a you can say slightly bigger than a house fly, right? It just wrinkles its wings very fast, and that produces the vibration in the air that causing a humming sound. And because of these vibrations and the fast movement of the wings, it can go forward as well as backward. It can go forward and can fly backward alternately, or whenever it wish. You can say it or assume it like that. So the hummingbird is the smallest bird that can fly both forward as well as backward or lateral. That means right or left without turning. Next, an egg-laying mammal is. Egg-laying mammal. Mammals are known to provide parental care. That means they give birth to their young ones, like calf or infant, etc. But there are only two animals, which are known to lay eggs. And these two animals are platypus and spiny ant eater. And both of these are found in Australia. If you see, most of the strange animals, birds, mammals, other animals, they are found in the Australasian continent, that is in Australia, New Zealand, Fiji, islands, or in the areas or in the small islands above. There are reasons for that. There are evolutionary reasons that when the earth split, forming the continents, Australia as a part of the continent went far away from the rest of the other continents, and hence the animals that were there, they did not develop or evolve as they should. Therefore, the animals found in these regions of Australasia are different from the others. And in those, the platypus and spiny anteaters come as mammals, that they have mammals, they take care of their young ones, etc. But still, they lay eggs like lizards. Right, and that's the answer here. And this laying of the eggs also supports the theory the scientists believe in, that the mammals have evolved from reptiles, that at one time the today's animals were like reptiles of past. Next, a reptile with four chambered heart is. If we look at Pisces, they have two. Reptilia have got three. Aves, mammals have four. Even amphibia have got three chambered heart. But alligator is a reptilia, crocodile is a reptilia, python is a reptilia, a snake, anaconda again a snake is a reptilia. All four are the names of the animal belonging to the class reptilia. But what the question says is that one of these four has got four chambered heart, and this only reptile having the four-chambered heart is crocodile. Crocodiles are the reptiles that are known to possess the four-chambered heart like aves, like mammals. The rest, they all have got three-chambered heart. Although, in some cases, what has happened is that if this is a heart like this, some of the development has taken place in the third half, but complete separation has not occurred. And hence it is also considered as a three-chambered heart instead of three and a half, because there is nothing like half an organ. It is either full or none. It is only in Reptilia that what has happened, that this wall has managed to develop completely, to divide the ventricle, the lower half, into two equal halves, into two halves, two separate halves, not equal, but two separate halves. So, the crocodile is the only reptile having the four-chambered heart. Next. The name flying lizard is used for alites. Alites is an amphibia. Chameleon is a coloring lizard. You know that this is a lizard found on the plants, etc., that can change the color. If it is among the leaves, it would appear green in color. If it crawls down onto the rock, it would change the color like a rock-like to mix. Or if it is back on the sand, it will change its color to look mix like a sand color, sandy color. And hence, the only name for the flying lizard is a Draco. Because it's a lizard like this, normal lizard, like the garden lizard that you see. But it has got an extension of the skin like this. And this extension of the skin allows it to jump from one tree to the another. That is the tree. Here is another tree. This lizard can fly, can jump over from one tree to another tree. And as it can do, or from one branch to another branch, we say it as a flying lizard. And the scientific name starts with Draco. Next. Among animals, the living fossil is. The living fossil is. Fossil means the animals that are no more alive. But they tell us about the animals of the past, that how they were. Such that now we can complete that how this particular species or particular animal has evolved from. Scorpion, tortoise, hydra, kangaroo. Kangaroo we can see. Hydra we can see. Tortoise we can see. Scorpion we can see. All four are living. And the question is saying living fossil. Now this word goes to scorpion. Because scorpions, you know, they are very poisonous. But what happens is scorpions are like monkeys. You must have seen monkeys. That the monkey, when the monkey has given birth to this infant, young one, they carry the young ones on their back while they feed them for some time of their growth and development. In same fashion, scorpions also lay eggs. When the young scorpions come, either they put them in their mouth or they keep them on their back as they move around to provide them the necessary protection. And it's only when those young ones have grown a bit bigger that the separation may or the separation will start. And hence, scorpions being belonging to the phylum Arthropoda, class Insecta, they are also considered insects, though venomous, though poisonous. They carry the young ones like the bigger, higher animals. They are considered the living fossils. Next, Coelacanth, the living fossil fish, has been discovered from Red Sea, Sea of Madagascar, Black Sea, Lake Victoria. Coelacanth is somewhere back in 1990s or 92s. A fisherman back in Madagascar, in the fish market of Madagascar, happened to find a very strange looking fish. And when he found that very strange looking fish, and ended up reporting it to the faculty there, science faculty there. The members visited and they searched for the other fishes and they happened to find some more. And when they looked at those fish, this fish of coelacanth, what they realized that this coelacanth or elacanth, as it is called scientifically, elacanth, they realized that it possesses the characteristics which were shared equally by the fish, by the pisces, and by the echinoderms. That it has got some of the characteristic properties that brings it closer to the echinoderms, that is the non-chordatas, and the other characteristic that bring it to the chordata group, particularly the fins and structure, respiratory system, etc. They looked into. And as it was first seen in the sea around the Madagascar, we say that it is the sea of Madagascar coelacanth was seen or captured or hunted first and is a living fossil fish, because still scientific word, the man or the scientists who are involved with the study of the fishes, they go there, pissy part of the animal sciences. Then, and in the Madagascar, you know, is a small island close to South Africa. 8, the outer skin of a frog is, frog you have seen in the rainy season, you see the frogs hopping here and there, jumping here and there. Moist and slippery, dry and scaly, moist but serrated with scales. None of the above. How is the skin of a frog? Have you, just next time if you see a frog, just try to hold it and see what happens. You'll find it difficult to hold the frog. Why? Because the frog, the skin of the frog is moist and slippery. Why moist? Because it can live both in water as well as in air. While in water, it can respire through the gases present dissolved in water like fishes, etc. from the skin surface, not gills. But once outside, it can breathe through the mouth but also can manage to respire through the skin. And to compensate for respiration through the skin, it keeps its skin always moist. So the correct option comes out to be the moist and slippery. The outer skin of the frog is moist and slippery. Dry and scaly skins are for the animals which are completely developed lungs, like lizards, etc., snakes, etc. They have the developed dry and scaly skins. Serrated skins. Serrated means sharps, like spines, if you see, like the saw of the tool that you use to cut the wood or a piece of timber. So it's not like that. It's not hurting. If you hold a frog, it won't hurt you or hurt your hand, until unless it is not a toad. Because in case of some toads, you may not know this, they may have a poisonous surface, poisonous mucus on the surface that can cause a burn on your hands, to your palms. Next. So with this, we have come to an end to some of these questions belonging to the this phylum Chordata, in which there were 5 classes, and each of these classes has got its own characteristic, and particularly we did pay much of the attention on the take of the birds like ostrich, the largest birds, warm-blooded, cool-blooded animals, open circulatory system, closed circulatory system, and then to the coelacanth found in the Sea of Madagascar as a living fossil, as well as scorpion. These were some of the pointers that we paid attention to. And these are questions which have repeatedly been asked in previous 4 or 5 or 6 years of examination that I had under different branches of the general sciences from the biology section. Thanks. Have a nice time, please.